bigger and bolder and rougher and tougher. In other words, motherfucker, there is no other. Yes, I am the Dominator. This is Stiff Right Hand. And this week my guests will be Kip Sabian and from TNA, Doug Williams.
It's the man that you fear, getting right in your ear. This is Stiff Right Hand.
Right, enough of that bollocks. Hello and welcome to Stiff Right Hand. Thank you all for tuning in. Thank you for your feedback on last week's episode with Sweet Soraya Knight. Got an awful lot of downloads for that one. A lot of great feedback. We're really happy with the episode. Big thank you to Liam for posting that and for James Hussle from The Rock Show Live for producing it. A really nice unique sound to that last week, and really happy with the way that came out. So big thank you for that. Please tune into The Rock Show Live, which comes on every Monday. It's an awesome internet rock show that Jim produces, and as you would have heard last week, did a fantastic job for us. The geezer knows what he's doing. Got a lot to talk about this week. We got our special guests, Kip Sabian. I spent some time with him, he's been around for ages, talking to him about his time in the job and what he's been up to, and also a very good old friend of mine, a real wrestling journeyman. He's been all around the world, he's pretty much done everything, Mr. Doug Williams. So we'll be talking to him about his time in wrestling and all things like that, which we recorded at the War Epic Studio show the other week. I've been training hard. We've got our big show coming up on October 21st in Hastings. As you know, that's going to be the big send-off for our dear friend Jinx, his last ever show. So we've decided to build the show around that, really. It's going to be a sad farewell, but also a big celebration as well, because he's brought so much to certainly the UK business, and done so much for so many young aspiring wrestlers. So we want to make that a really big deal. So I've been training hard, been pushing the guys hard at the Wrestling Academy as well. This is the first show, which I'd say is 80% of the card is guys from our academy. I'm very, very proud of that. And it's something that I've wanted to achieve in a long time. You know, I've never been big on bringing imports in. Not because I'm a cheap motherfucker, but because I truly believe that the quality of wrestling in this country is better than anywhere in the world. And I won't be moved on that opinion. I think we're the best. I think that's been proven by the fact that wrestlers, from the big guys to the small technical work rate guys, are being recognised all over the world, in mainly in Japan and the States. You know, from your Pete Dunne's to your Marty Scurll's, all of those guys there, they've been representing the country so well. And I think the scene now over here is better than ever. And if you don't make it abroad right now, it doesn't mean that you won't one day. But enjoy what you're doing over here, guys. This is what I say to my students now. You do not realise how fucking lucky you are, because this won't always be here. It's a really, really important time for British wrestling, and we are in a golden era. I've said this time and time again. And all the guys who are out there, whether you're at my wrestling school, whether you're at schools up and down the fucking country, some good, some shit, keep your head down. You got two ears, one mouth. Keep your mouth shut, head down, fucking work hard, and who knows what you can achieve. But my guys and girls at the Extreme Academy, very, very proud of them. A lot of them now starting to come through. Got their own gimmicks, their own characters, their own movesets. So, you know, really slick and polished. And so this is going to be a really good stage for them to show their shit as well. So I'm really proud of that. So I've been training hard. Had a little week off after the war show, just to let my body heal up a little bit. Getting older now, and after a little while, the joints start hurting and shit. So I said to my training partner, look, let's fucking ease up just for 5 or 6 days. Let our bodies heal and give ourselves time to fucking grow. And we did, so we went back there this morning, and, you know, I miss that place. I love my Zeus Gym. I don't know if any of you have been down to the Hastings area, please check it out. It's the best gym. I love it there. It's like a second family to me, all the guys and girls there. It's really got everything, certainly everything I fucking need anyway, and I wouldn't really want to go anywhere else. Going in there this morning. I see so many young people, man, coming in. I was in there early this morning. I got in there nice and early. I had a bit of breakfast, getting there to train. I was all fired up to do some shoulders and traps, and got guys coming in there fucking yawning. And there's a few guys that come in there, and they've been going there for fucking years. They've got no gains at all. They don't ever seem to change their body shape. They just remain looking like a fucking, you know, they just look like a fucking barbell, these cunts. They just walk in there yawning, scratching their ass, fiddling with their dicks. You see, fucking guys nowadays, what the fuck's all that about? They're talking to each other, guys fiddling with their junk. But what the fuck's all that about? I don't understand that. I'd have been doing that. Some of my mates would have slapped me up fucking side of the head. Stand there chatting to your male friends, playing with your dick. What's all that about? So, you know, ridiculous. Carry on. It's, you know, why? And they're coming in there yawning and fingering their asses and, you know, just sitting around on the fucking machinery on their phones and that. And, it really pisses me off. But I try and, I find it jaw-dropping sometimes, but I try to, after I told a couple of them to get off the fucking machinery that I needed to get on, it didn't spoil my day too much, but, if any of you motherfuckers are listening to this, stop it, and stop playing with your dick. I've had a few little questions come in to me from our readers. Had a couple of good ones here. Craig, as you've got a question for your podcast too. What's your opinion on Dave Meltzer and Brian Alvarez? He's gone on to say, personally, I think they're like two stooges that watch a product purely to find something to complain about, and their voice is great on my tits. Well, thanks, Craig. I've never actually heard either of them. I'm assuming they do podcasts. I know Dave Meltzer has been around for years and years and years, and writes. He was one of the original dirt sheet writers in the times before the internet, and he's one of the main guys who seems to get all the hot gossip from WWE before even some of the boys in the back seem to know about it. And I know a lot of the WWE guys fucking hate him and want him dead. They've got no time for him at all, don't like him being around. Dave Meltzer and Brian Alvarez, I guess I'm gonna have to check him out is the answer to that one, because I don't really know enough about him to answer that one. Years and years ago, I used to fucking be a dirt sheet writer myself. That's how I wanted before I got into wrestling. You know, back in the tape trading days, people used to trade tapes. You didn't have access to the wrestling shows like you did now. So you used to send tapes out, and, you know, so another guy would send that. He'd have a copy of some random fucking Japanese death match show where people get blown to fuck, you know, like the Terry Funk death matches. And send your tape out, and you'd send them something back, and you'd be on the tape trading circuit. And then you'd, you know, the dirt sheet sending, you know, so you'd be finding out results from shows. You know, you'd never, you know, you got to hear about stuff like Smoky Mountain and stuff you never got to watch on TV. So, I've got a lot of time for that. At the end of the day, anyone who's promoting wrestling in a positive way is good, in my opinion. Whether they're a dick or not, I don't know. But if they're promoting it and putting it out there, then fuck it. They're not doing any different than me, are they? My man, Dominic De Winter. It's a really good question, this. He said, you know, I want to know about your opinion on the ever-changing role of the Wrestling Academy and its responsibilities. He said, I see the role of the Academy not only to produce good ring workers, but to play its part to cater to other areas of personal development, things like pastoral care, i.e. the Academy being aware of the overall welfare of the trainee. Do you agree? Yes, 100%. Our Wrestling Academy, I know it sounds cliched and cheesy and that, but the Extreme Academy of Wrestling it's been a family first and foremost. I've always been very proud of the fact that EWW, people say, oh, Stu only books his mates. Well, yeah. Just happens my mates are fucking good workers, and also, what, you know, I want people around me who I can trust. There's not that many people in the world you can trust. I want people around me who I know are good people, and you don't want any bad apples. If you have any bad apples in the locker room, fuck them off. The guys that you know are going to be snitchy, fucking going to be a pain in the ass, going to slag your product, they're not team players, etc, etc, fuck them off. Life's too short to have those people around you. You need to weed your garden and get that shit out. So to me, I've always had my best people around me, and that's the way I've always had it. I trust my wrestlers to do their own stuff. I don't go around fucking scripting shit. I don't fucking go around telling my boys, right, I want you to do this, 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 and this. And that's what I pay them to fucking do. You know, I don't need to tell guys to finish. You fucking sort your match out. You do. I trust you. I've paid you to do a fucking job here. You do the job. You don't need to be micromanaging people as a promoter. And so, much the same way at wrestling school, I teach people about every aspect of wrestling, from literally, we spoke about it the other week, from going around to shaking people's hands, to, you know, personal hygiene, to fucking, you know, to trim your fucking underarm hair, motherfucker. You got someone in a headlock and you got those straggly little fucking hairs hanging on, I'm gonna yank those cunts out by the root. You know, how to look after your, how to look after your finances, how to promote a show, you know, get out of there, sell tickets. Well, you know, we give the guys back £1 for every ticket they sell. You know, so you fucking go out there, you sell 20 tickets, you get £20. Bosh, it's an incentive. You know, all of our guys know that they can come and see us, whether it's me or Tarn, and speak to us day or night about whatever they need to talk about. And, that, you know, whether it's wrestling or not, we are a family unit. And I know that sounds cheesy, and it's not how everyone wants to run there, so that's fine. But to me, that's how it should be. You know, you're taking young people and putting them through, you know, not all of them are going to fucking make it in wrestling. Not all of them are. Some of them like just coming along to, because they enjoy the camaraderie or enjoy the, you know, the keep fit aspect of it. But some of them are naturally good and they're not going to be travelling the world. Some of them will just be doing some spot shows around the country. Some of them will just be doing my shows. But it doesn't matter. Still stories they're going to be able to tell their grandchildren in fucking 30 years' time. You know, I did do this. I did make an impact. I put bums on seats. People paid to watch me do my thing. And, you know, you owe them. Because, you know, you owe them to teach them the right way. To have manners, to be respectful. So the pastoral side of it, yes. The answer is yes, I do agree. 100% with that. And I think you do need to, if you're teaching, you need to teach everything. Not just how to put on a fucking armbar. Another question here from Jake. Jake, he said, "Hey bud, question for the podcast. What was your favourite match and rivalry from the EWW time era at the Palace nightclub?" We used to run shows at the bar. I used to work on the door for many years as a bouncer at the Palace nightclub, and it became one of our main venues, and they were real fucking ECW blood and guts style shows. I'd say, fuck, I can't even remember any standout matches for me personally there. I enjoyed my matches with my mate Frankie from Florida there. I think one of the best ones was Phil Bedwell against Ash. That's where Phil lost about 3 pints of fucking blood, man. Those guys were hitting some outrageous shit. And I mean, outrageous. I made Phil sit back and watch it not too long ago, and he said, "Oh, dude, I'm sorry. You know, we were doing all this shit before the main event and had to get our shit in." But let's be perfectly honest, everyone fucking does now anyway, so it didn't really matter. It was nice that he fucking acknowledged it after all these years. But, you know, he lost some serious... There was, at one point, blood shooting horizontally out of his fucking head. It looked ridiculous. It was insane. But some of the fucking stunts those guys were doing was nuts. So I'd have to say that would be one of my favourite ones, just because we used it on all our promo packages and freaked everyone the fuck out with it. Also, your thoughts on your time at WrestleForce when run by Charlie Rage. Bless old Charlie. Charlie's one of my best friends. I haven't spoke to him in a year, I think, but Charlie used to run shows at WrestleForce at the big theatre in Harlow in Essex, and they were really unusual fucking shows, but they were really spectacular, the lighting, and he used to put so much effort into the running of the show. From a technical standpoint, he almost used to forget about the actual wrestling itself, so we'd get there early and you'd end up having to be sitting in the bleachers watching him going through the dance routines with the girls. And oh man, it almost became a running joke in the end, you know, Charlie fucking leaping about like Larry Grayson on the stage. But bless him, we had some fucking mental times. I remember I just got over pneumonia and he said to me, "I want to film a car chase scene where we go out and you chase me in the fucking car and I'd have banged up on Ford Mondeo, and he's got like this fucking monster truck. And then we're going to pull over, and then we're going to have a fight, and then we're going to drive further down the road. Then my mate's got a bar. We're going to go into the bar, which is full of people, and we're going to fight through the bar. I was like, oh, man, you're killing me with this shit. Anyway, we did it, and it was in the fucking winter. It was January. I was dressed up in all my wrestling gear. It was an absolute cunt. But we do not the fuck out of each other, and it was funny. But looking back on it, it was nuts. It was fucking insane. So a lot of those shows, looking back on them, they were absolutely ludicrous, because Charlie's a fucking nut job, bless his heart. I love him to pieces, but he's mad as a box of frogs, and his vision was very good. I think I wish he'd kind of stuck at it, actually, because I think there was much more I think he had much more to come, but he was so interested in so many other things. I think he'd have probably ended up having an aneurysm, and his head would have ended up blowing up if he'd have carried on doing it. But they were fun at the time, and yeah, weird old times, man. But look, we're going to get to our first of our two interviews now. The first one is with Doug Williams. I've known Doug for many years. Doug's one of the greatest wrestlers that this country's ever produced. He's done it all, pretty much. He's one of the hardest workers and most natural wrestlers that I've ever seen, and that we've ever produced. I wanted to talk to him about his old mentor from Hammerlock, and some of the old stories, and some of the boys that he grew up in the business with, because things like that always get neglected in interviews, I tend to find. So I wanted to speak to him about Andre Baker and things like that. And so anyway, here we go. Give it a listen, see what you think.
Read all about it. Doug Williams smashed in Scarlett's Minky.
Hi, this is Stu Allen. I'm here with one of my good old friends. He's one of Britain's finest wrestling imports, in my opinion. He'd probably balk at the idea of me saying that. But it is true. And I'm here with the anarchist Doug Williams.
Hello, Stu, you all right?
You all right, Doug?
Do you mean export? I'm not an import, am I?
Did I say an import?
You did, yeah.
Oh, what a cunt. Sorry about that, mate. Export. We're a fine export.
Thank you.
Of one of the finest. Right, Evan.
I'm sure they've all heard it before. Well, maybe.
So, Doug, tell us a little bit about I would say it would have been mostly yourself, Jodie and Johnny, who were the guys who were instrumental in bringing British wrestling to where it is now. What were your memories of the old FWA days?
Cool, blimey, so many of them. Random, hectic, unorganised, chaos. Do you know what? When you're in the middle of something like that and just getting on with what you're doing, like wrestling and everything, you don't appreciate everything's around you or anything that's happening, or you know what you might be doing to affect fans,
exactly,
like or people watching or anything like that. You just get on and do it. And I just consider myself lucky, really, that I managed to get a break and you know, get out on a global scale, really. And if that meant that I helped raise the profile of British wrestling during that time, so much the better.
Well, you definitely have done. Like I said, yeah. I speak to a lot of guys on the indie scene in Florida who have a lot of good things to say about you. Obviously, they probably only know you from your TNA days. They don't remember all the really good stuff that you've done.
Yeah, I know.
You know, prior to that, because I mean, you were one of the first breakout guys from the famous Hammerlock School.
That's right. Yeah, I would admit, literally the original class. I was there. I think Andre opened it in like May 93, and I was there in July 93.
Tell me a little bit about Andre Baker and his method of teaching. So I've heard lots of different stories from lots of different people, and I'm quite interested to hear that.
I'll give him his due, Andre. When we first started there, he'd get in the ring, he'd show us bits and pieces, because we're all clueless, aren't we, you know, when we start. And he'd bring people in to train us, like Tony Scarlo would come in, Palo would come in, other guys, local wrestlers and all this and that. So, you know, yeah, I don't know what other people said, but he did make an effort, and he did want people to train. And he ran shows that lost money. Mm. You know, he'd book out a hall and he'd draw like 150 to
We've all been there.
Folks in these Cliff Hall and places like that, just to give us experience. So, you know, people might say something about his training methods or how he didn't do anything, or he might sit there reading his paper and eating his cakes and all that. And yeah, he did. But to me, if you're there for 6 hours a day, right, which I was there 6 hours on Saturday, 6 hours on Sunday, someone not going to be showing me stuff for 6 hours straight. I want to be in there for a few hours doing my own thing, learning things, practicing myself. If I get a few points from Andre, so much the better. So I'm never going to complain about his training technique.
No.
He said he gave me that facility in order for me to train.
Gave that platform, yeah.
I get people that I gained experience from. So it was fine in that respect.
Yeah. But it speaks for itself, doesn't it? The amount of people that came out of that place. Well, so it's you, Johnny Moss. Johnny Dodie.
You got DeVitt,
exactly.
Law, you know.
Christ, people, forget about it, came out of Hammerlock was right. The school, wasn't it?
Yeah, there's a few other guys kicking around that I think are really good. John Ryan, I don't know if you ever met him.
Yeah, I did some shows in Maidstone with him. Well. He's a solid worker, isn't he?
Yeah. Do you know Danny Garnell as well?
Now, Danny's our new commissioner.
Oh, right, yeah.
I love Danny.
He's another Hammerlock guy.
Yeah, I love Danny,
there's
man.
All sorts of names, you know, like.
Classically trained British wrestlers, but you're all lads that look like you could all have a row, if you know what I mean.
Well, that was the other thing that Andre was big on, is you start from the bottom and you work on the fundamentals and like a little bit of shoot fighting. And the final gym that could be, he had three gyms over the course of time I was there. The last gym he was there in Sittingbourne was run by a judo guy, and we'd have a load of stuff with him as well.
So we
do a lot of judo sort of stuff as well. So building it from the bottom upwards, you know, and getting that mat based experience.
How do you feel wrestling? Obviously, we're in kind of another golden age, aren't we?
Yeah.
We had it in sort of like the early 2000s stage, where we did the thing with Bravo when you went on with Eddie Guerrero.
Yeah.
Which was just saw that match again the other day because I started doing the rounds again on Facebook. Forgot what fucking hell of a good match that was actually.
You ate me up. Oh, I hate it.
Really?
I fucking hate it. He ate me up like I'm... Yeah.
I didn't want to say that, but only because I know you and I've watched you for years, is that only I could kind of tell you weren't comfortable about it.
No, I was just nervous.
But it was a great match.
Yeah, you know, at the end of the day, you come out with something, don't you?
Well, exactly. You know, you had the bollocks to get in there and do it. You know what I mean? Whereas I didn't. So, you know, you were the man who turned around and took the challenge and did it.
Yeah, that's it.
You know, phenomenal match it was as well. But like I said, how do you feel like, you know, we're going for another resurgence in British wrestling? But I was talking to Scott Hall earlier and saying, do you think wrestling's got a little bit softer in the fact that the guys don't work as snug now? And, you know, you're seeing little things like the sexy star thing with Rosemary the other week, where she took to Twitter and had a little moan about her, you know, popping her shoulder out. Now, do you think wrestling's got a little bit softer?
Yeah, it has. It's becoming more, you know, what I'd say is performance-based. You know, like the fans are not... It doesn't present itself as a serious competition anymore, like a sporting contest, like two guys actually having a fight anymore.
Yeah.
And it doesn't pretend to be that, which is fair enough if that's what it wants to be. But you're never, in my opinion, you're never going to break past that crowd that they've already got doing that.
Mm.
You know what I mean? If you want to bring in the casual punter person walking down the street, you've got to at least project to him that you're having a serious fight. Even if it's not really a serious fight, he's got to believe that what he's watching.
Absolutely.
Is two guys who want to beat the hell out of each other. And that's the thing that's missing now. Until you get that, you're never going to expand past the audience, which is a good audience that we've got, don't get me wrong. It's a huge audience at the moment, but it's got a finite number of people involved in that.
Agree.
You know?
A show's got to be a show, hasn't it? There's room for comedy, there's room for work rate, there's room for big men. But, you know, have a show as a show. I see so many guys in kick pads coming out. If you want to watch a fight, go and watch UFC.
But even so, even if you get all these different types of matches, the one basis behind all of them is they've got to look like, at the end of the day, you want to have a wrestling match.
Yeah, and so you'd agree that that's lacking.
Yeah, definitely. 100%.
Yeah.
Taking nothing away from anyone.
No.
That's the way it's gone, you know what I mean?
I totally agree. And it brings me down a little bit now. Right. So in my twilight years doing it, I find I kind of throw myself into doing the school and doing the podcast and things like that. Because I do want to kind of stay active in it, but I find, obviously, you know, use yourself as a perfect model of someone who's come from the old school and kept it real throughout. You've managed to keep your wrestling style very current.
Yeah.
As well. How difficult has that been? Because you've always been very well known as a technical wrestler, but now you've got more crowds who dictate to the fucking wrestlers.
Yeah, it's tough. And I mean, like, the main thing that I see now, and me and Chris Daniels having this conversation a couple of weeks ago, saw him at a show in Germany. It's just that guys, on the whole, are smaller now. When me and Chris Daniels started out in 93, we were the junior heavyweights. I weigh like 16 stone, you know? And, you know, he's like 14, 15 stone. Now, the average size of a wrestler is much smaller than that, and I'm the heavyweight. You know what I mean? So I have to change my style up for that reason, if nothing else. You know, where I am or how I'm seen or portrayed has to be different to how it was when I was younger, when I was a technical wrestler. I had to overcome the odds of being on against a bigger, powerful, more, you know, stronger guy. Now I'm the strong guy. But for no other reason than everyone else has got smaller. Not that I've got any bigger. This is a crazy thing, you know.
But nothing, but like I said, it's very clever. Your work rate has always remained consistent.
Yeah, it has. It has. And
and no one's ever questioned it.
No, no.
Whereas me, I wouldn't stand up. I wouldn't be able to, you know, get fucking, you know, if I was on a progress, yeah, I'd stand up like a spare prick at a wedding.
Maybe, but it's just, you'd be booked correctly, wouldn't you, hopefully?
Yeah, but like I say, you've always managed to you've always managed to get past that, and I've always found that pretty admirable. How long do you think left you've got in the job?
A year.
Really?
Yeah, I reckon so.
So you surprised me there.
Yeah.
Because you're getting married now. Oh yeah.
Okay. Well, I will be. Yeah.
You're going to be a betrothed.
Yeah.
So how's that going to change your life?
Oh well, it's different now because I've got family and everything as well with that, so I can.
Yeah, because you seem quite settled and very happy.
Yeah, yeah. That's killed the travelling bug in me.
Really?
I like being in different places. I hate going there, though. I hate the travelling aspect of it.
She seems very nice natured and good laughing, old Mrs. Evans. Seeing some posts on Facebook. She's much like Tarn in the fact that she's quite outspoken and
definitely.
And she's very.
She doesn't take any.
No, I
can't believe. She blames me. Can you believe that? She says, I was so laid back before I met you. Oh, no, that can't be.
She seems really cool, though. She seems like she's got her head on her shoulders and she keeps you grounded, which I think every good man needs a woman like that in their life.
Yeah, yeah.
So really, you only think a year left?
Yeah, I think so, because I've got neck issues and knee issues.
Do you think you would go down the route of opening a school?
Probably not.
Really?
No, I don't mind doing seminars, but I've tried it and I've got patience, to be honest with you.
I think that'd be a real shame. I'd hate to think that wrestling would lose you completely.
Well, no, I don't think I'm not going to be locked. Yeah, I'm not going to walk away completely. I'll probably try and do get involved in other things. You know, we'll see. You know, I don't know. I like to seminars would be one thing I'd do if I could get to do some commentary for people if they want that sort of stuff. You know what I mean?
Just excellent.
Or something where I can add some value. You know, and still be around and do things. That's cool.
Excellent.
Too physical, that's the only thing.
No, I understand that. Well, look, thanks a lot for your time, Doug.
No worries.
Really appreciate that, and always good to see you, my man.
All right, mate.
Cheers, buddy.
Shake on air.
Appreciate it. Yeah, that's good. Cheers, dude.
All right.
You want the truth? You can't handle the truth, you cock jazz. This is Stiff Right Hand.
Right, that was our little chat there with Doug Williams we had last week. What did you think of that? Oh, Mum, by the way, now I'm here with Tanya.
I'm here now.
You're here now.
I am here. What is it that you call it? The Room of Spoons?
The Room of Doom.
Womb.
Spoons.
Okay. Well, it's the kitchen. Hey, I'm here.
How are you? How's your day been?
I'm all right. It's been a busy day. It's been a bit of a pickle of a day, to be honest, because all the electricity blew in the shop. And then I went there and then I said a few cunts and fixed it because I'm a woman can.
Did you fix it though?
Did you fix it?
Is it all going to be safe and secure?
Well, no, it might be on fire tomorrow.
Yeah.
We'll see.
So, we're going to get to our little weekly piece we have now.
Do you want to go straight to cunt of the week?
In all fairness, that person is the absolute cunt of the week.
Oh, that's Brian Dixon, thank you.
It's fucking cunt of the week,
much
mate.
Appreciated, cunt of the week. Well, this week,
fucking cunt of the whole week.
This one, we've had a couple of cunts of the week so far on our last two episodes. This one is unanimous.
Yeah.
A few years ago, we did a show for a friend of ours called Sebastian P. Sterling in Maidstone, and one of the wrestlers brought along a guy who appeared in Big Brother 8, apparently, called Bill Batty. I'd never heard of him, never seen him anywhere do anything. Anyway, he came along. He looked just like fucking Jazzman from Babylon Zoo. And that's not being racist, how he fucking did look. And he turned up and made a complete cunt of himself, basically. He was rude, he was obnoxious, he was getting under everybody's skin and just being basically an arrogant prick. And then I think what happened, the thing that wound me up the most and made me go off, was when he did an in-ring segment with you, didn't he? Like he did an in-ring interview with you.
Yeah, and he just had no fucking clue about the wrestling business or whatever. He was just like, absolutely fucking a twat to me. He was all like, tried to put himself over at my expense rather than doing his job. And sort of, I don't know, just thought that I was fucking stupid and that I that he could make himself look good.
It was a little throwaway interview segment. He basically made some remark to you, and you, I think you said to him something along the lines of, well, no one knows who the fuck you are.
I said, steady on, mate. No one here knows who the fuck you are.
And I don't know whether he did it over the mic or whether I heard it backstage from someone else, but apparently he called you...
He called me a fucking junky slut.
Yeah, so anyway, of course, word gets back to me in the back. So I went out there.
Frankly, my drug use and sexual preferences are none of his business.
But I went out there and... the show had finished, the punters left, and I can't really remember it because I was in such a fucking red haze, but I remember him running away.
He ran away and cried. And he hid behind Dean.
I remember, yeah, I just steamed out there, and he'd be fucking...
You wiped blood on his shirt in your match as well.
Yeah, we went over, and me and the guy was wrestling with... he'd done a blade, and this geezer Billy was wearing... It was like best Armani shirt, so I said to my opponent, I said, come on, let's go over. They got him in the headlock. We went over to the commentary position, and I purposely rubbed blood all over his new white shirt, and of course he tried to get in my face. I was like, I'm what, motherfucker? And so come the end of the night, yeah, he was nowhere to be seen. He fucking hightailed it out of there. And apparently made some comments fairly recently, within about the last 2 or 3 years, about me on Twitter.
Anything to be relevant, eh, love?
Anything to be relevant. But again, now he's caused an absolute shitstorm. he turned up as a fan. He seems to have this obsession with wrestling. He's obviously got some sort of fucking need to be around the business and around the boys. And he's obviously got...
It's a shame that the boys think he's a fucking cunt.
Well, he's obviously got some massive sexual repression. And obviously, you know, fascinated by males wrestling. But... turned up at this show last night, and you take over the rest, basically.
Well, no, it was in response to one of Jimmy Havoc's tweets, and Jimmy was actually standing up for a younger female wrestler that was on the same show as him, who was upset by, or rather the fans were upset by, her defending herself in a fucking ferocious and in their view negative way, because someone shouted, "Get your tits out," at her. She's a 17-year-old. So, like, her age, I guess, in this is irrelevant, but kind of is a moral point, because she's technically, am I going to say, I don't know, like, that's quite young to be fucking...
It doesn't matter. The point is, you're straying away from the subject, the fact that this geezer was there shouting, like, get your tits out to a female performer.
Yeah, well, that's fucking out of order. And Jimmy Havoc, rightly anyway, he tweeted about this. And just basically said that anyone that did that is a cunt. And he's right, because, like, you can't argue your case for fucking behaving that way. When someone's fucking entertaining you, you don't do it. It's not the same as heckling a heel. It's not. It's fucking using sexual language to be fucking awful to a woman.
So some of the tweets back and forth.
Yeah, basically. So anyway, what happened was Billy Batty weighed in on this. As he always does with anyone that's getting any social media attention, I guess, because that's what he does. He jumps on fucking trends and stuff. But he said, let me find it so I can read it to you. He said, "Why shouldn't men chant it? They have their right to. A large percentage aren't interested in seeing women wrestle and want them in their eye candy role." Well, I would say to you, love, come down and see the fucking hundreds to the thousand people that we draw, to not see me in an eye candy fucking role, but to see me throwing around bigger, stronger men than you.
And also I'd argue about an eye candy role to who?
Yeah. That's just like, that's assuming that everything on this planet is for the male gaze, and it isn't. Why shouldn't men chant it? They have a right to. Men do not have a chant to be they don't have a right to be sexist fucking creeps.
No, and what's the other one that he's come out with?
There's fucking loads. Shall I just read you a bunch?
Well, he's made himself look an absolute bell end.
Here's a doozy. "Wrestling utilised women as sex objects, and men liked it. Now they expect consumer attitudes to change on a whim? No."
The fact that female wrestling is at an all-time high now is exactly the reason why this prick's around. He's always been one to jump on whatever is the biggest thing going to try and get on the tailcoats, and this obviously is what he's doing. He knows what he's doing, And in this instance, he's done fucking well at it. But the amount of people on there that have taken against Jimmy and what Jimmy said, and Jimmy's dealt with them really fucking
Jimmy's
well, actually.
Yeah, Jimmy's been nothing but fucking class. Actually, today was the day that I became a Jimmy Havoc fan.
This proves to me that fucking... You know what? I'm glad our wrestling fans at EWW are not smart for smart, because the smart fans, any smart wrestling, fuck off. I'm like, you know, you're, oh, we pay your way. You don't. So smart fans don't fucking spend money. You don't. you don't make any fucking heat. You don't make any. All you want to do is see people get fucked up. You're the equivalent of the people that go along to a fucking to an air show to watch a plane crash. You're a bunch of fucking cunts. And all the smarts that are going out there along with and agreeing with Billy and saying, oh no, it's absolutely right, it's absolutely right, you're a bunch of little fucking mummy's boys sitting at home in your basement.
Well, it's the only opportunity you get to talk to women, I would imagine.
Yeah, to talk to them and interact with them, and it's, you know, there's no fucking, and you think you're a big part of the show, you guys, as well, and you're not.
Yeah, it's like Billy Connolly said, like, so, what was it, when the lights go up on us and down on you, it's your turn to shut up.
Lights go up on me and down on you, it's time to shut the fuck up.
Yes.
And that's exactly right, and it infuriates me that people didn't round on him and call him a cunt. I'm calling you a cunt, Billy Batty, and I'll tell you what, if you are listening, I don't care if you are or not, I'll fucking meet you anywhere. And I know you won't because you're a little fucking pussy, but I'll fight you anywhere for any amount of money, or for no amount of money, or just for charity, because I think you're an absolute cunt. And you know I think you're a cunt, and I'll tell you you're a cunt again. I can't wait to see you, and I hope I do see you again at another wrestling show where you're there beating your meat, not to the women as well.
Do you fancy a game of hide and seek? No, fuck that shit, it's cunt of the week!
So there you go, there's our third cunt of the week, and well done, Billy Batty. That's probably the only thing you've won in recent
Billy Batty, cunt of the week.
Giving you your weekly dose of a kick in the nuts. This is Stiff Right Hand.
Well, I've just found one of my best friends here at war. He's a lovely lad, Simon Kip Kipping. Hello, Kip.
Give it name.
Talk to me.
Hey, man.
How are you?
I'm good. How are you?
Don't be shy. Welcome to Stiff Right Hand.
I'm excited.
It's not a podcast about arthritic wankers.
Oh, what? Why am I here?
Oh, you just like me? You just inquired about my T-shirt at the Ben Rye Club.
I did.
I'm going to get you one of these.
Can you send it out to me?
I'm going
to
get you one of these.
Do I have to pay for posting?
No, we'll sort it out, brother.
Post for Stiff Right Hand?
Yeah.
There you go, see?
We'll sort it out. I want to talk to you about your very, very swift rise to popularity. You're getting booked everywhere now.
I know.
Why? Is it because you smell so good?
I think it is. Like, naturally, naturally it's like roses.
You do smell nice.
Roses and strawberries.
Are you always one of the ones I look forward to hugging the most?
Oh, me?
When I see you, because you always smell good.
Don't tell Tom.
She knows. Tell us about what you've been doing, man, and your new gimmick.
Oh, where do we begin? So well, obviously I spent a long time doing my generic babyface character.
So tagging with Brad,
yeah, me and Brad
edition.
Did a special edition, which was going really well. I then moved to Leeds and decided to give a sort of heel run a go. I suppose I've been thinking about it for a long time.
This is your super bad character.
This is the super bad character. Basically just an arrogant up himself.
I saw one of your matches recently on Fight TV.
Did you? Who was it?
And I can't remember now. It was one of your ones for, I think it was a Fight Nation. Was it Fight Nation?
Was it Fight Nation or Hope, maybe?
It might have been Hope.
Might have been Hope.
But it was the first time I'd seen you as a heel, and I thought it was very good.
Thank you. It's because I'm a natural dickhead. Or so I've been told. Apparently it suits my personality more.
No, it's very good. I liked it. Well, I was a big fan of Special Edition. I loved working you guys. Mm. And I thought you and Brad were a hell of a tag team, and I was kind of sad when you split away from that, because I thought you guys could really be NXT.
Well, the thing is, we're still trying to tag where we can. Like, we've got a few tag team bookings coming up, but with location, like, as you know, if you're a tag team and you're both opposite sides of the country. It's quite hard
very
to say to it, like yourself as a promoter, to then go, oh, can you bring me from this way, and then can you bring
which
this
is what we've just found out, isn't it?
We have found this out.
But it hasn't affected your bookings, because you're getting fucking, I see you booked absolutely everywhere now.
I don't know. I think just I'm able to put more of me into the character, which sounds quite bad, because the character
is a bit ridiculous. No, that's absolutely awesome.
It's easy, like, I think these days as well, everyone kind of secretly likes a dickhead.
Yeah, yeah, it's especially a cool dickhead.
Yeah, and that's the thing, like it's not so much just people love to hate the guy. Like, I get quite a lot of fans that will cheer me because I'm a dickhead, whereas when I was a good guy, they weren't really that keen. So it's a strange...
Well, it's a different demographic, because when you and Brad were tagging up, it was like you obviously had all the kids going nuts, because I used to see you guys as like the biggest merchandise machine I've ever seen, tag-wise. I thought you were so good, and like I say, I liked you both especially because, having worked you personally, for two guys who fly around and, you know, your work rate's through the roof, you both work really, really snug too. Not stiff, but you both know, I like to work with people who I know are there.
Well, that's the thing, I mean, like that mainly just comes from training at WWE.
That's your upbringing.
It is, like, and I generally believe that is the way it should be.
Yeah,
like,
but all your stuff meant something, do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
As a tag team unit, and I was just watching Brad's match just now with Aaron, and I said to Dave, I said, fuck, I miss those guys tagging.
Oh, mate, like this is the thing. Brad should be everywhere.
Yeah, he should.
Constantly. Brad is...
That's awesome.
When I first started sort of breaking out this year, so to speak, everyone was like, oh, like, he's so underrated. Brad is the most underrated wrestler in the
UK. I'd agree.
In my opinion. Like, he should be everywhere, because I'm going to be honest, Brad's a better flyer than me. Brad can do...
Really?
Yeah, Brad's an amazing
flyer. Because Brad's a big guy. Brad's tall. I mean, you forget he's so deceptively tall, isn't he?
Like, he's now sort of progressed his way, obviously, when he did the WWE heavyweight run, where he had to be a heavyweight. But Brad can do all. Brad can technical wrestle with the best. Brad can go toe-to-toe heavyweight with the best. He can fly with the best. Some of my best flying matches have been with Brad.
Really?
Yeah, Brad's amazing. But it's just now...
But you gelled so well as a tag team. I mean, I've been tagging for years with different people, and it's not easy to have that chemistry. No, you two had really rare in-ring chemistry.
I think it's because outside of the ring, we've been best friends since we first met.
Mm.
Obviously, when we first met back in WWE in 2009, 10, something like that, straight away it was like, you're the other guy that has a fringe. you like Green Day? I like Green Day. Like, straight away it was like, you'll be my best friend. And then we've been best friends.
Well, I remember when they put you guys together and immediately you clicked, and I said the chemistry was there. There was some of the best tattoo wrestling in this country I've seen in a long time.
We wrestled you sort of very early on in our tag team career back then.
And then your first singles match, the first time I saw you in a singles, I think, was not long ago against Jody Fleisch.
Yes.
And that was a fucking hell of a match.
Jody's very good.
Jody's awesome, but Jody's don't put yourself down, man. Jody, it takes two.
No,
I remember that finish was phenomenal. That was that's the only match on the card that I watched all the way through, and it was savagely good.
I think, like, for me, that was probably my big moment, because up to that point, I'd not really, like, wrestled a big name. Like, not taking away from guys like Roy and Zach, but because training with them,
you see them all the time.
But it's like an outside name. Like,
gave you that match, obviously, because they saw something in you.
Yeah, no, and I'd been a big fan of Jody for so many years. So for me, it was like, this is the guy that put British cruiserweight.
Jody, to me, is always the best in the world.
Oh, yeah, still to this day. I was watching him the other week.
He's lost nothing.
Him and Johnny going out
there. And he's Jack now.
This is the thing. So him and Johnny going out there and doing a match that is just as good, if not better, than it was back in the Johnny-Jody
days. Johnny and Jody's matches, for me, one of the greatest matches, and I don't care how many times I say it, I never get tired of it.
And it's always changing.
Yeah, it's always changing. They've kept it current.
I'll watch it every single time.
But they were doing that shit in fucking, like, 97, 98.
And now, what's the thing that seems to be over?
So those guys were doing that, man. Exactly. And it's phenomenal. But like I say, you... You've stepped up. Tell me about your. You got to wrestle with your hero, Rey Mysterio.
Yes, that was ridiculous. I didn't actually find out until the day.
How did that feel?
That's so weird. Everyone asks me, and it's a strange scenario to be in, because obviously as soon as they told me, right, you're going to be wrestling Ray, I was like, okay, this is a big moment. Like, I don't know if I'm ready right now. Like, do you know what I mean? You start to think. And then obviously when he turned up and I said hello, I was still like, oh, this is like one of the reasons I got into wrestling. As soon as then it was like, right, let's talk about wrestling, boom, it literally just felt like it was any of my friends in the locker room.
Oh, marvellous.
And like, he was...
Isn't that the wonderful bond about wrestling, though?
It's brilliant. And like, that's the thing that I love about guys like Ray, is he's been there, he's done everything, still to this day, he's busting his ass. Like, in the match we had, he was busting his ass just like he did.
It was a hell of a match, man.
It's crazy, but like, he was such a nice guy. Like, they sometimes say you don't want to meet your heroes, but he was...
I couldn't agree more with that.
Absolutely brilliant. And he had nothing but nice things to say afterwards. So.
Well, you got the best of both worlds there. You got to meet your hero and you got to work with your hero and find out the Arsenal McKay that he was an awesome dude.
Exactly.
And encapsulated by that wonderful picture that Brett King took of you guys together, which Hannah and which got you down on the canvas.
Yeah, and it is on my wall.
And I popped for that because I was like, damn, that picture is the nuts. And then I was a hell of a picture, man.
That's the thing. Literally, the second that I saw that picture, I was like, thank God. Because secretly in my head at the end of the match, I was like, well, I'm going to take my
time. I hope someone's caught this shit.
Because I really hope there's my hand. Let's slowly, okay, let's take our time. Hopefully someone's taken
it. That was a real one in a million shot, wasn't
exactly.
it?
And now it's on my wall for all time.
So what's next for you? What have you got coming up?
I don't know, really. I haven't really thought about it. I live every day as it comes.
Do you get involved in the scene up north a lot?
Bits and bobs. Like, I do a lot of the NGW stuff. So like their TV tapings, obviously their stuff on the Butlins camps, which is sort of our northern crew. But most of my stuff's kind of all over.
What about your music?
I don't really do it anymore.
Really?
Yeah. Time. More than anything. Like, well, no, that's a lie. Time is a terrible option. Since obviously things...
It's one of my favourite herbs.
That's the thing. Like, since...
Because you're a really talented musician.
Yeah, I mean,
and I was literally just talking to Doug. We were just discussing about all my favourite people to talk to in the locker room. Obviously, you're one of them. I always relate the most to people who've got other strings to their bow other than wrestling.
Well,
I always like to talk, you know, movies. I like to talk music, and then when I found out that you're a really good musician, and I've heard you play live acoustically as well, and you're very naturally very good.
I mean, like, the thing is, like, a few years ago, I went through a phase where I was contemplating switching to music and slowly phasing out of wrestling before obviously things started picking up. And as everyone has, you have those moments where you just start to feel, that's not really going the way I want it to go. I'm starting to feel a bit demotivated. And then my music picked up. I mean, I'd always played the guitar, and my housemate for so many years was a brilliant lyricist and vocalist. So we'd been playing just random gigs here.
He was the guy I used to gig with, yeah.
So Steve Farrell, Knotted was the band name.
Yeah.
Just plugging their mum. But I contemplated doing music full time, and I slowly was phasing out of wrestling. And then I had a match with Nick Aldis in...
I remember that. That was a nice match
last
too.
Last year.
Right? Yeah.
And it was only like maybe 5 to 6 minutes TV match.
Mm-hmm.
And afterwards, Nick just plugged me and bigged me up and did loads for me. And that got my love back into wrestling. So that was when I said...
It was a sweet match, man. That's the one with about a million finishes.
No, but this is the thing. That's why...
I got blown up just watching it.
That's why I was just trying to get Nick blown up. no, he was trying to blow me up. But that was where I went, right, I'm going to have to make a decision on what I'm going to do. Because as much as it's great to have so many strings to play, at the same time, you can't make a living out of something unless you go, right, I'm going...
That's very true.
So
you're at a young age where you can do this, and exactly. It's obviously paying dividends.
And this is the thing, like, I had a cushy full-time job. I was earning quite good money where I was, but I realised that if I wanted to make a go of wrestling, I'd have to start full-time. And that was where I still was working where I was working. I was saving up as much as I could. Me and Hannah moved back to Leeds, and I'd built up a few relationships going forward and was like, right, I can probably make a go of this now. And luckily since then... So that was February. Since February, I've been able to wrestle full time, which has been.
How about the injury front? Have you been pretty lucky on that?
I've been alright. To be fair, I mean, I got knocked out last week.
As you do,
by a female, which shows how strong
females
can be. But no, that was just an accident. knocked out. Don't remember what happened.
But, I mean, considering you wrestle a very smash-mouth, high-risk style of wrestling, your body's held up pretty well.
I've been really lucky. Like, there's been a few, like, tweaks here and there. Like, I tweaked my knee last year, and I thought it was bad, but it wasn't. It just healed itself. I had my shoulder maybe 4 years ago, and that's never been better.
So you've been pretty lucky.
I've been really lucky. Like, I've not had any sort of head injuries. Apart from, like, my nose, like, years ago in France, that got busted and broken out, and I had a knock on that. Check me out. Nose job. You wouldn't know.
I'm sad to hear that guy died recently. The guy took he took us to France.
Oh, Pascal. I know. Ridiculous.
Yeah.
I haven't been over there since. Maybe 20.
Well, you went over there, I think, about 2 or 3 months after we did.
Yeah, we did. And then we did about 3 or 4 after that.
And he was a lovely little fella. I was all sad to hear.
Always backstage.
Yeah, warm on me.
Cigarette in his hand.
Yeah, proper.
Being told he weren't allowed to smoke, but he didn't care.
Yeah, he was a proper old school little.
I had no idea what he was saying, but he was just a really nice bloke.
Yeah, he was lovely, wasn't he?
It was quite upsetting, really. But he always treated us really well.
Same.
Always put on food afterwards.
Same.
I don't miss how long those journeys were, though.
Oh, man. Yeah, that's because Robin always sticks you on a fucking shit cheap ferry, that's why. It ain't no problem, man. Back. Yeah, you'll only be sitting in your car for 9 fucking hours, man.
There and back.
Yeah, cheers, Robin.
Leave at 1 in the morning on, say, like...
Yeah, well, the other fucking Dover ferry's fucking off out there. You're sitting in a fucking chicken cargo.
Yep.
Yeah, cheers, Robin. Yeah, and I'll get on to talking to Robin later. We'll find this shit out, man. I've got heat with Robin about this.
I'm well upset about that. And then it's like, you like finish the show, and you're like, oh, I've now got to wait 4 hours till 3 or 4 in the morning for my ferry back.
Oh, mate.
You get on the ferry and you're just sitting there going, what am I doing?
Fucking depressing.
What is it? But I think, like, now I look back on those memories really fondly.
I do.
Like, and even now, like, so last night I had, like, I can't remember what time I got back. But I got back at like 5:30 before driving here today, so I didn't really get much sleep. I got like an hour of sleep. But like, at the time, and right now, I'm sitting there going, oh, this is ridiculous.
And right now?
Yeah. No, but like, do you know what I mean? Where you're like, I feel so tired, like this is horrendous. But then I reckon in, say, like a few months' time, I'll look back and go, what an idiot. Why did I do such a thing? But like, you look back on it fondly, and now I look back on the... At the time, I didn't look back at the France trip, and we're sitting there going,
oh, mate.
Well, any another?
It's not fun sitting in your own ball juice, is it? Do you know what I mean? It's fucking miserable. Tell me, just finally, because you got shit to do, what are your goals? What would you love? I was just talking to Doug as well, saying about WWE, everyone thinks it's the be-all and end-all. I believe firmly you can blaze a trail for yourself in this business in it by other ways. What would you love to do? Be it Japan, Mexico, what is it would like to do?
100%.
I could see you in Japan.
I'd like to, thank you. I've always been a big fan of Japanese wrestling.
They'd love you over there, wouldn't they?
I love it. Like
they'd love your hair. Like,
well, that's the thing. I do have the best hair in pro wrestling. I'm going to
until I grew this, baby.
Well, no, to be fair, you are looking very well
done. Yeah,
you look like in the, well, you've got like the sort of barbershops these days where they've got the beard and the hair. You literally have.
Actually,
the
call me a hipster.
You are. You, yes.
You're hurting me, man.
You are a hipster.
You're hurting me. I'm right here.
No amount of tattoos and muscle can take away
I'm
that.
I'm right here.
Yeah, I know. Yeah, and I'm now putting my defense on. Kicking him back.
So, Japan, I can see you in Japan, dude.
I mean, to be fair, ultimately, I would like to go to WWE at some point, but I'd like to do it where I've gone out and done everything that I could first before doing that. So, like, Japan is on my list. If I could get Japan and then I retired, I'd be happy that I actually managed to go.
I'd be thrilled to bits to see you do any of those things, man. I'm very, I'll perhaps call your friend. I think you're one of the nicest guys in the locker room. You're always very humble and very kind, and I wish you all the best in our... Look forward to seeing your career flourish.
Oh, thank you.
No, not so. Now sing me a song, though not very long.
No.
Oh, fuck you then.
From the man whose wife has a broken badger, thanks to Doug Williams, this is Stiff Right Hand.
Right, so there's my interview with young Kip.
Lovely.
No, so our son, isn't he?
Well, I would like him to be our son. I want to make sure that he's all right, and I want to make sure he's got a sandwich and a nice duvet.
He very nearly wasn't all right when he called me a hipster. I wanted to punch him in the throat.
You couldn't hit that face.
I couldn't, really.
Couldn't.
No, he's a lovely boy.
He's like shouting at a puppy.
Oh. Oh, no, I feel sad. No, he's lovely. I love Kip very much. He's one of the few people in wrestling who, when you normally say people are a nice guy, that normally means they're shit. How so is that? He's a nice guy. He's famously shit. Kip's one of the few people whose niceness matches his talent. He's actually phenomenally talented and is genuinely lovely, and I want to give him a cuddle.
And you do?
Slip my finger up his bum as
no,
well.
No, don't finger his bum. He can't be our son if you're going to do that.
And can.
No.
We're our secret son.
No, that's not appropriate. Anyway, what's on next week?
Fritzel son.
No,
Fritzel son.
What's on?
Kip is a Fritzel son. Fritzel son. Fritzel son. Hey, he is a Fritzel son. I'll poke him up there, bum.
Hey, he is a Fritzel. Kip, you're not going in the secret basement.
Oh.
I'll protect you.
Fritzel son.
Do next week.
So next week, I've got an enormous transatlantic episode next week.
That's easy for you to say.
Yeah. So it's going to be an American episode. It's going to be...
What?
American. American episode.
I thought you to do that accent.
What?
Whatever that
American. So next week's going to be our transatlantic episode. I fucking counted it again.
It's all right, just go.
It's going to be another episode with Americans on it. And it's going to be have one of my longest ever, oldest friend in wrestling, a man who was at Skullcrushers Wrestling School with me in 1994. We turned pro together, Francisco Chiazzo, who was, I don't know why he calls himself that. I think Paul Heyman gave him that name, actually. But he did
do him a favour, did he?
He's called, he didn't help him out there, but all Paul Heyman, give him a stupid surname.
Yeah, Paul!
He was Uptown Frankie Capone back in the good old days, but now it's Francisco Chiazzo, and he is having a movie done all about him called Journeyman, and we're going to be talking about that, and he's wrestled for every major promotion there is to wrestle for in the States, so that'd be awesome to catch up with him, and also... the main event next week, going to be talking to the bad guy, Scott Hall, a.k.a. Razor Ramon.
Hey, yo,
baby doll. Is it okay if I spank your ass?
No, Scott, it's not.
Hey, yo. Is that ass biodegradable?
Why does the big guy keep entering the other guy's head?
Why does the big guy keep fucking around all the time? So, yeah, we like to argue me and Scott and roll down the hill and punch each other in the dick, but we managed to be sensible for long enough to conduct a half-sensible interview, so we're going to be bringing you that next week. So anything from you, wife, before I sign off?
Well, I want some dinner, so sign off.
Well, you're in charge.
I am fucking in charge, and everyone's heard it.
You're in charge of my tea and my life. You're in charge of my tea as my wife. Anyway, thanks for tuning in once again. This has been Stiff Iron. I'm the Dominator. This is Tony Allen. And this has been Stiff Iron. Thank you.
Yeah, love you. Bye.
Toodle pip.